Papa l'americano. In this video, we'll discuss the relativistic momentum and force. So aside from the length and the time, and also the transformation that we need to revise, we need also to revise the formula for the momentum and force, and also with the work done and energy for a relativistic motion. So in this video, we will focus on the revision of the momentum and force. And in the next video, we will revise also the work done and energy, and to provide also the energy of a photon. Okay, so let us recall first for the classical mechanics. If we have the particle whose mass is m travels with velocity v, then we understand that the product of the mass and velocity is actually the momentum. So momentum is directly proportional to the velocity and also directly proportional to the mass, which means that the greater the mass or the greater the velocity, the greater the momentum. Now, since the velocity is a vector quantity, then momentum must be a vector also. Okay? Now, what will happen if we have the relativistic activity? So, therefore, the motion now belongs to relativity. Okay, so for a very high speed velocity, momentum is again relativistic. And it is defined as the product of the real relativistic momentum multiplied by the velocity. But the relativistic momentum, mass is equal to the mass over square root of 1 minus v squared over c squared. So therefore, substituting this value here, we come up with the relativistic momentum equal to the product of the mass and the velocity all over the square root of 1 minus v squared over c squared. This is the relativistic momentum. Okay? Now, if the velocity is much less than v, less than to the speed of light, now take note that this will become zero. So therefore, the square root of 1 is 1. So the result is actually leading to the classical mechanics principle of momentum. But if the velocity approaches speed of light, then therefore this one will be subtracted by a number. So if you take square root of that, it is less than 1. So therefore the result is actually the momentum now is greater compared to the classical formula. So therefore, again, this is a generalized formula for momentum, for this can be used any motion, any speed. Okay, so now for the relativistic force, suppose I have a mass object A whose mass is ma and it has a velocity also b. It has a mass of mb and it has a velocity in opposite direction to a, so they will collide at a certain point. So if they will collide, then it follows there must be a force in between. We call that as the colliding force. Okay? Now the force actually, during interaction, mass A has a force due to the interaction of B. So it's a force that B exerts on A. And we have also the force that A exerts on B. So they have the same magnitude of force, but in opposite direction. It is actually followed by the third law of Newton. So the sum of the two must be zero, because whatever force experienced by A, it is the same amount of force experienced by B. So the sum must be zero, for they have opposite direction. Okay? So how much is the force on A due to B, or how much force on B due to A? So that will be our task for today. Now, we will have a force parallel to the velocity. So we will derive the relativistic force parallel to the velocity, and after that we will derive also the relativistic force which is perpendicular to the velocity. Okay, so the second law says that the force is actually the product of the mass and the acceleration. Where take note that the acceleration is actually proportional to the force. Whatever direction of acceleration will be the direction of force, vice versa. So now take note that acceleration is the change in velocity per time interval. So therefore we can substitute here A with dv over dt. So therefore we have this. So therefore force is actually the product of the mass times the change in velocity per time interval, or the acceleration. Now since mass is a scalar quantity in mathematics, m is actually a constant, treated by a constant, so therefore it can be moved inside the derivative, or it can be placed outside the derivative. So if we put m inside the derivative, this will be the result. This is d dt of what? The mass and the velocity. But remember that mv is actually the momentum. This is in classical. Okay? So therefore, the net external force during collision is actually the change in momentum per time interval, or the dp over dt, which means that the force is proportional to the change in, directly proportional to the change in momentum, meaning the final minus initial, and it is inversely proportional to the time of collision, so the number of hours that the two objects meet each other, so during the collision. So the time of collision is inversely proportional, meaning the smaller the time, the greater the force. But if you have a greater time of collision, you have a smaller amount of force. Okay, so this is the force due to the two interacting particles. So if we substitute the momentum in relativistic momentum, so this will become d dt, which is equal to mv over 1, or square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. Okay, so we will evaluate the derivative. So we have to recall, you have to recall the principle of calculus, the differential calculus, differentiating this mv over square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. Now since the force is parallel to the velocity, then this velocity is actually a function of time. Okay, this is a function of time. Also the velocity inside the radical sign is also a function of time. So therefore this will treat as the variable. But c is actually independent to t, because c is always c, while velocity varies with time. Why? Because force is parallel to the velocity. So we need to recall this theorem. This is actually quotient rule of differentiation. So if we have u over v, the derivative, take note that we need to preserve one at a time. So we have to reserve first the denominator, then take the derivative of the numerator, then it will be subtracted by the u. So this time we will preserve u and we will differentiate dv. So it should be v du minus u dv, then divided by v squared. So this is the theorem, the rules of differentiation for the quotient rule. So we will apply this theorem here to differentiate this the derivative. So first is we have to preserve this one. Take note, preserve this one, then take the derivative of mv, then subtract by preserve again. We'll reverse. We have to copy the mv, then take the derivative of square root of 1 minus b squared, then all over the square of b. Our b here is square root of 1 minus b squared over c. So do it. This is it. So since mass is mass is constant, so if we can move it out from the derivative, so that's why E must place here. And we copy this one, the denominator. Then we have to take the derivative of the velocity with respect to time. So we have dv over dt. Then subtracted by, theorem says, minus, copy, okay? So copy the numerator. Then take the derivative of the denominator. Okay, then all over square the denominator. That's it. So then, all you need to do is, by the way, this is part of your answer. This is also MB is also part of your answer. But we need to differentiate again the dv over dt. And this one, also, we need to differentiate this with respect to t. Now, remember, v, again, is a function of t. So, we cannot take this as constant. But c, actually, a constant. But since it is the denominator of the variable, then we cannot easily move it out. So, then, square, we have to square this. So, therefore, we can remove the radical expression for the radical sign. So this is purely 1 minus b squared over c squared. And now take note that dv over dt is acceleration. So this will be acceleration. Then we copy. This is only part of the answer, mv. Now this one is we have to apply the technique, another technique of integration. Okay. So all you need to do is to let u of this number. Okay. Then you have to take derivative. So again, you need to go back to your calculus. But the shortcut way, since this is, look at this one. This is second degree. Okay. And we have here, okay. This is second degree. Then we can use this just like a power rule. So therefore, this will become 1 minus b squared over c squared. Okay. So, the quantity raised to 1/2. So, all you need to do is to have the 1/2. So, just like, it is just like a power rule. So, you have to dive in the exponent here, then subtract it by 1. But, we have to continue. We need to take derivative of this term because this is a function of t. So, look at this one. This one is acceleration. So, this is actually copy. This 1/2 is actually taken from the exponent of 1/2. So we dive the inch is like a power rule. Then we subtract 1/2 by 1, resulting negative 1/2. Okay. So this is actually just like a power rule. But we need to continue because this is the base is actually a function of t. So we need to differentiate. We need to differentiate the by the way, 1 is 0, so therefore purely the derivative of negative b squared over c squared. Okay, so this is 1 minus b squared over c squared. Then continue. So take note that look at this one. Okay, so differentiating this one, by the way, differentiating this will become 2b squared. Okay, 2b squared over c squared. 2b squared over c squared, but take note, b is actually a function of t. So this is actually an implicit differentiation. Because this is not t, this is b as a function of t. So first is you have to differentiate this thinking of t. So this will become 2b squared, okay? 2b where minus 1. So therefore, this will become 2b over c squared. But we need to differentiate again v because this is a function of t. Okay. So then, next is, okay, this will become acceleration, remember. dv over dt is acceleration just like this one. This is acceleration. So we will arrange. Then, we have mb times 1/2. Okay. Quantity multiply by negative 2b over c squared. So take note that this will become b and b is b squared. So therefore, this will become ma, mass times acceleration. This b times b is b squared. Then multiplied by c, and this 2 will be cancelled out. Okay, this 2 is cancelled A negative becomes plus. And this is quantity 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to negative 1 half. This is negative 1 half. Okay. The next is we can factor out MA. So we can take it out, MA. So therefore, we have what? We have square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. Then we have plus, this is b squared over c squared because MA was moved outside for the common factor. And we have 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to negative 1. So we just copy this one. Okay, so look at this one. Now since we have two terms in the numerator, we can share the denominator. Okay, because they have the same denominator. So take note that this is 1 square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared, and this is 1 minus b squared over c squared. Square root. So the radicand here is the same as the denominator. So if converting this into exponential form, so that we can combine these two. And this one also, this is negative 1 half, and this is the same, no? The radicand and this denominator is have the same value, but this is raised to negative 1, while this one is raised to 1. So we can apply the law of exponent to reduce. Okay, so this is the result. Now take note that this is, again, 1 half. Then this is minus 1. So therefore, it is negative 1 half. So therefore, put it denominator. So this will becomes 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to 1 half. This one is negative 1 half minus 1. Take note, law of exponent. So negative 1 half minus 1 is 3 halves, negative 3 halves. So put it down, becomes positive. Okay? So that's why we have here 1 half. And this is 3 halves. So take note that these two are have the same base, but they have different exponent. So combine the two fractions. So take the LCD. The LCD is 1 minus b squared over c squared, 3 halves. So LCD divide this one, then multiply by 1. The result is 1 minus b squared over c squared. LCD divide this one. So the answer is 1. Times this one, b squared over c squared. Okay? So when you remove the grouping symbol, this will be eliminated. Take note. Okay? This will be eliminated. And this will become 1 over 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to 3 halves. Okay? So therefore, this is the formula. Relativistic force for the force parallel to the velocity. Which means that the direction of velocity have the same direction of the force. So if that happens, this will be the formula to be used. And it is actually equal to the product of the mass times acceleration divided by 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to 3 halves. Again, this is the force parallel to the velocity. Now in terms of Lorentz factor, this will become Lorentz factor cube mass times the acceleration. Why? Because this, take note, the Lorentz factor is 1 over square root of 1 over square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. Okay, so this will becomes y cube. Oh no, Lorentz factor raised to 3 mass times the acceleration for the force. Okay, now what will happen if the force is perpendicular? Meaning, force is, for example, horizontal, the force of the velocity, but the force is perpendicular to that in the vertical position. So therefore, what will be the relativistic force? Okay, going back to this equation, so we will differentiate again, but this time, this velocity actually does not affect the, this is not dependent to time. Why? Because the force is perpendicular to the velocity. Unlike previously, that the velocity actually affects for a function of time, it's because that the force is parallel. But for the perpendicular, the velocity inside the radical is actually not a function of time. So this can be treated as constant. So in that case, we can move it out. So we have mass also is a constant. So mass over square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared, and we have purely dv over dt. Now take note, dv over dt is acceleration. So therefore, the relativistic momentum, oh no, force, for the force perpendicular to the direction of velocity is simply as the mass times acceleration divided by square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. But the force parallel to the velocity is mass times acceleration over 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to 3/2. That's it. So these are the two formulas of calculating relativistic force. So in terms of Lorentz factor, so this is simply as what? This is simply as Lorentz factor multiplied by mass times the acceleration. Okay, so let's have the example to have a relativistic momentum and the relativistic force. An electron, so it has a rest mass of 9.11 times 10 raised to negative 31 kilograms. And the charge of the electron, remember, is 1.6 times 10 raised to negative 19 coulomb, is moving opposite to the electric field. So it is opposite because that it is a negative. Of the magnitude, 5 times 10 raised to 5 newton per coulomb. All other forces are negligible. So therefore, the interaction of the other particles are much smaller compared to the effect of the electrostatic interaction or the electric field force. Now, letter A, you are asked to find the magnitude of momentum and the acceleration at the instant when the velocity is 0.01 of speed of light. Okay, or this is 1% of the speed of light. Then, next is we will find again the momentum for the 90% of the speed of light, or 0.9c. And we have the 99%, very close to the speed of light. So what will be the magnitude of the momentum and its an acceleration? Okay, so then letter B, what find the corresponding acceleration if the net force is actually the same magnitude in perpendicular velocity. So therefore, by the way, first we will solve the momentum, then after that we'll proceed to letter B. So we will ignore the acceleration. We will find only the magnitude momentum, then after that we will proceed to letter B. The force is perpendicular, so what will be the acceleration? So we will ignore this question because I have the solution for the momentum only. So okay, so let us recall the formula that momentum is mv over square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. Then for the force relativistic parallel, we have ma over 1 minus b squared over c squared raised to 3/2. Okay, then for the perpendicular, m a over square root of 1 minus b squared over c squared. So for the solution, now we have to use this formula. Okay, now take note that we are looking for the velocity on the momentum at the velocity of 0.1. By the way, this is 0.1. Sorry, this is not 0.0. This is 0.1 or 10%. This is a very, very small. Okay, so change this to, or remove this 0. So 0.1 or 10%. Then, take note that the mass m here is actually the mass of the electron. So substitute, this is 9.11 times 10 to the negative 31 kilograms. Then, the velocity is 0.1c, but c is 3 times 10 raised to 8 meters per second, divided by square root of 1 minus 0.10c square, take note of the formula, then over c squared. So we can cancel actually c squared. So this purely a square root of 1 minus 0.1 square, then this must be divided from the product of the mass and the velocity. And the result is 2.7 times 10 raised to the 24 kilogram meter per second. Okay? Now for the 90% velocity, 90% of the speed of light, we have 0.9, substitute almost the same, but you have to change this to 0.9. And the answer is 5.6 times 10 raised to the 22 kilogram meter per second. Okay, then finally, we have the 99%, which is 9.11 times 10 raised to the 31 again, and we have to change the velocity to 0.99, and this is also 0.99. Then substitute, we have 1.9 times 10 raised to the 21 kilogram meter per second. This is the unit of momentum, kilogram meter per second, because kilogram is for the mass, meter per second for the velocity. So, by the way, if we solve the acceleration, this one, where suppose the force is parallel, then we have to use this formula, this one, then substitute the values, okay? Because we have the, by the way, we have the force. Take note that the force, this is electrostatic force, and the force is the product of the charge of the electron. This is 1.6 times 10 raised to the 19 multiplied by the electric field. So that's for the parallel. Then everything, so therefore this is actually calculated, mass is 9.11, so, and the velocity is the same velocity, 0.10, okay? So then we have the result, okay? So we can calculate the velocity. If the force is perpendicular, then use this formula. So again, this one is the same. This is the charge of the electron, 1.6 times 10, because the electrostatic force is the product of the charge and its electric field, because electric field is the force per unit charge. So therefore, take the diagonal product, the electrostatic force is the product of the charge, the electron, multiplied by the electric field. Okay, so again, by the way, we have this one. Force is equal to the charge of electron times the electric field. So therefore, we can substitute here. So we are now on the letter B. Okay, letter B. So then substitute the force here, then solve for A. So force is QA. So solving for A, then we have what? A is QE square root of, by the way, this is, please cancel this one. This is not included. This A was already removed. So divided by the mass. So again, the charge of electron times electric field square root of 1 minus B squared over C squared, eliminate this one, then all over the mass of electron. This will be the formula, revised formula. Because we have, take note, force is can be calculated, so therefore we can solve for the acceleration. So substituting for the values using the same velocities, we have three velocities. So for the 0.1 of C, substitute the values. This is the charge, 1.0609 times 10. By the way, this is 1.609, no, or sometimes 1.6. So I use 1.609 times 10 raised to negative 19 C. Then the electric field is 5 times 10 raised to 5 Newton per Coulomb. Then square root of 1 minus 0.10 C square over C squared. So C squared can be canceled out. So then therefore, simplifying, divide by the mass, 9.11. And the result is 8.8 times 10 raised to 16. Okay? So then, for the 90% of C, so the same formula, but we need to replace the velocity here. So again, the result is 3.8 times 10 raised to 16. Then we have the 99% of the speed of light. So the result is 1.25 times 10 raised to 16. Okay, these are the answers for letter B. Take note, the force, Okay, the same magnitude of force, but it is perpendicular to the velocity. So therefore, we use this formula. Again, for letter A, if we will solve acceleration, so this is actually almost the same, but you have to use this formula. So this will become what? This will become 1 minus b squared over c squared quantity raised to negative 3/2. So it differs with the formula. Okay, so for now, all we need to do is to remember the formula for the relativistic momentum and the force parallel and the force perpendicular to the velocity. That's it. This is all about this topic. Okay, so thank you. Yeah.